church. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Why don't you all just stand, begin our worship. The Father, with the Spirit, one with the Son of God, one with our sisters, one with our brother, one family by the blood. Your will be done. Let your will be done. Kianda da da ba. Shikianda da da ba. Slow. Let you make us one. Yo! It's the power, yours. It's I'm let your will be done. Your will be done. Let your kingdom come. Shikianara. That's all we ask for, Lord. Let us be one voice that glorifies your name. Let us be one voice declaring that you win. Let us be one voice in love and harmony. And we pray, oh God, grant us unity. And we pray, oh God, grant us unity. Lord, come. She can da 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 da. She can't.
that you unite us as a family, as a church. She can da 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 ba. Slow. To come, rain down. She can da 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 ba.
We stand on your word. Let your rain fall upon me. Let your rain, let your rain fall upon me.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I speak to every dry bone in this place right now, that in Jesus' name, ignite those dry bones right now, God. Let your Spirit, oh God, fall upon each and every one of us. That, Lord, not even dry bones will take us down. But God, ignite us, oh God. Ignite us, oh Lord. Ignite every one of us. Burn, oh God, a passion, a fire in all of us. Let not that fire extinguish, oh God. Oh God, we proclaim that, God, you are the Lord of our lives. And Lord, we declare that, God, you reign over this church. Lord, we declare that, Lord, you reign over each and every one of us. And so right now, oh God, we declare, oh God, that, Lord, you are going to do great things, oh God, for this church. Great things, oh God, are yet to come, oh Lord. We give all our dry bones to you. That, Lord, today, oh God, this Sunday, oh Lord, will not be any other Sunday, but a Sunday, oh God, that you're going to do great things, and we're going to expect great things from you, oh Lord, today. That miracles will happen, oh God. That demons will be cast out, oh God. That everyone will be delivered, oh Lord. That healing will come, oh God, even today. Lord, we expect that to happen, oh God. We know and we believe that, God, you're going to make that happen. And so we put our trust, we put our faith, we put our hope in you, oh God. Not on anything else, but only on you. But even as we move to the next part of the service, even as we move, oh God, ignite every dry bone, oh God. Every dry bone. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you. We give you all the praise and glory. In Jesus' name I pray. And all God's people say, Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As the ushers get ready, let's also pray for the tithes and offering. Can I have my slides, please? Thank you, Jesus, for your grace, your mercy, your love, your provision upon every one of us. I just also want to pray, oh God, that, Lord, for some of us here today, or in fact, many of us here today are facing any kind of financial difficulties, oh Lord. Lord, I pray that, God, you bring peace into their lives, oh God. Bring peace, oh God. Help them, oh Lord. Carry them, oh God, through whatever financial difficulties that they have. Hallelujah. We know that, God, as we give back to you, we are putting you first, oh God, in our lives, especially in our finance. And as we do that, oh God, we know that, Lord, you will open up the floodgates of heaven of blessing upon each and every one of us. We ask that you bless the tithes and offering as we give. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. We're going to go through with some announcements. Later today at 2 p.m., there will be a live group leaders meeting at the multi-purpose hall. So I've actually texted some of you individually. So please make sure that you'll be there at 2 p.m. Okay? Next week, we will have a guest speaker, Reverend Stanley Lim, a great speaker, and he's got great things in store for all of us, especially from God. So please make it for this. This is important, okay? I'm sure God has a word for all of us through him, okay? Reverend Stanley Lim, next week at February 19th. Okay, and then the next one will be, we're going to have a Bible study, a book of Romans, next week as well. So I'm going to call up Uncle Jason, Brother Jason Tan. He'll be up to explain a few things. Let's give him a hand.
Good morning. Good morning. So next week, we will have our study of the book Romans. Romans is a very long book in the New Testament. So I just give you a little bit of what we're going to study from this book of Romans, okay? It will answer you some questions and also give you some nuggets of what we need for our life. The first you will learn that what are Christian responsibility towards the gospel. Okay? Those who study the book of Acts, if you remember, in the book of Acts, chapter 13, from 13 to 52, God has inserted our job description in 40 verses. For those who can remember, study the book of Acts, you can remember, you get a packet of Japanese chocolate. Okay. Yeah, in 40 verses. Amazing, amazing. Give you a hint. For those who have NIV, you just look for all the P's. And God has given us a job description, exactly like how the secular world gives a job description. Okay, sorry. I got to go and find. Okay, second, creation versus evolution. How do we put atheism to rest? Okay, atheism will eventually lead to satanic worship. All right? So how do we counter this atheism, and should not waste too much time with them? Number three, know that every faith or religion has a cross to carry. Whether they are Muslim, whether they are Hindu, whether they are Taoism, do you know they have a cross in their religious book? So how do we use this message of the cross to reach out to this group of religious people, whether they are Muslim, Hindu, or Taoism? You can share with them the message of cross without offending them. And they'll be surprised. Only the Christian cross has been fulfilled. All their crosses have not been fulfilled. Okay? You'll find out. Number four, why Christians are shortchanging themselves. We have now not fallen short of the glory of God, but we are fallen short of the blessed life in Christ Jesus. Okay? Number five, have we misinterpreted Romans 8, verses 28? Find the key to unlock the verse. Is there such thing as once saved, forever saved? Okay, let's find out together. What is spiritual adulterous? Do you know there is a word? Oh, sorry, it's not written there, but there is spiritual adulterous. That's why a lot of Christians doesn't bear fruits. God have not forgotten the Jews. Remember them in prayers. How to enter God's perfect love, all right? And finally, God's work requires teamwork within a community of believers. So all this we will explore together. We will not dwell so much on theology because time is short. We know that the end times are coming. What we want is to learn all this so that we can do witnessing. We can share, all right? That is more important, all right? We learn how to share with those unbelievers. We know how to talk to them without really offending them. Okay? I hope all of you all can join. And for those who are, I think it's for all levels, for those who are more mature, I think you can come and we share together. You can contribute also, all right? So thank you so much. We'll see each other next Sunday.
Let's give a hand to Uncle Jason, everybody. You know, growing up as a kid in this church, I've been to Uncle Jason's Bible study ever since I was a kid. No, not so as a, like probably in high school, secondary school age. And I've always thought that he can do some kind of narration for like BBC, you know, Planet Earth kind of animal documentary. He has a very, as the tiger moves into the field, you know, he has a very good voice. Okay, so don't wait up anymore. Go ahead and register. There are lots of good stuff for this Bible study. I can guarantee you, Uncle Jason is good at what he does. So come and hear, and it's for everyone, okay? Don't say that I know everything, okay? Say that I want to learn, okay? So you come for this Bible study and you can get to learn. Last thing is that we're going to pray for Uncle Lawrence Chen. Can you come over? For those of you who don't know, Uncle Lawrence is actually leaving for Penang soon, okay? So I'm just going to... You want to say a few words, Uncle Lawrence? A little bit of an update. Yep.
Oh, my house is in Penang, and my wife and my son and family are all in Penang. So meanwhile, through the years here, I've been working most of the time as a teacher. So this year I'm already 67 years old. At the end of September last year, just a few months ago, I had a fall in a toilet. So after that fall, I had to search myself and ask a long question. Should I continue to work or not to work? So in the end, I made up my mind, I need to go back, all right, to stay back in Penang. It's also because my son and my daughter-in-law, they are also both doctors. They're still staying above me. So they will be able to, you know, look into my health problem. Okay? So I just hope that you can just pray for me. So what do I do when I go back to Penang? So in my mind, right, I'm thinking that I should join a church. I'm not decided which church to join. Either I join my son's church or my wife's church. I'm not sure which one. But I will hope to take part in the church service. Maybe something like Uncle Jason, something like that. Okay. So this is the gist of my departure, which will be roughly, maybe I'll be leaving either end of February or beginning of March until all my things are settled. Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. Can we all stand? And I'm going to call the board members to come. Let us all stretch our hands to Uncle Lawrence. Uncle Lawrence has been in Canaan for many, 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 many years already. Okay, and it's really sad for him to go. I've always admired him because he's very articulate in his words. I mean, as all teachers do, lah. Okay, shall we all stretch our hands to him? Amen. Hallelujah. Let's uphold in prayer. Hallelujah. Father, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Father, we commit Uncle Lawrence into your hands, O God. You hold his future. You know the plans and purposes that you put in his life. We pray that, God, you will continue to use him mightily for the glory, for your glory. Continue to use him mightily, O God, to touch people, to impact people. Continue to use him, O God, to in whatever ways, O God, you want him to do and want him to be. He is a vessel, oh God. He is your vessel, Lord, to fill up overflowing, oh God, blessings and blessings, oh God, in his life that he cannot contain it till he has to bless people as well. I pray, oh God, for his health, oh God. I pray, Lord, in Jesus' name, that God, you will cover him, oh Lord, from the top of his head to the soles of his feet. That God, he will have new strength, oh God, divine strength from you, oh Lord, in Jesus' name. The divine strength from you, oh God, to continue to do the things that you have called him to do, oh God. I pray that, Lord, you will heal him and you help him to have a recovery and give him, Lord, whatever that he needs, oh Lord, through this season, in this life especially. I pray, oh God, as he goes to Penang, I pray that, Lord, you will never forsake him nor leave him. You continue to be with him. Your presence, oh Lord, will go before him, oh God. And that, Lord, even though he is 67 years old, I pray, oh God, that, Lord, you will continue, oh God, continue to move him in such ways, oh Lord, that, God, Only you can do, oh God. We thank you, oh Lord. We love you so much. We commit Uncle Lawrence into your hands. Bless him individually. Bless his family as well. Bless whatever that he does. And I pray that God, whatever he do, he brings glory to you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 It is quite sad because, like, you know, people come and go, you know, people's seasons come and go. It is quite sad, you know, that, you know, people have to go to another kind of season in their life. But we always hold that promise, right? That God's word, God's promise always remains. So we wish you all the best, Uncle Lawrence, to whatever season that God will take you. And I believe God will definitely take care of you. Amen. Amen. Okay, we're gonna go with today's message. Continuing the series on We Are the Church. There are two parts to this. Last week was part one, where we talked more in detail about 1 Corinthians 3. Verse 9, right? It's written there, for we are God's, we are co-workers in God's service, you are God's field, God's building. This is the theme of our church. If some of you have missed out last week's sermon, you know, we talk about 1 Corinthians 3, where Paul says that it's time to grow up. Time to grow up by, you know, eating solid food and not depending on milk. We have to grow up spiritually because it's time to grow up for us to think right before we do church right. We have to not lean on worldly wisdom, not lean on our carnal minds, but to lean on the Spirit, to walk in step by the Spirit before we do church right. And that will lead us to focus on God, not on people, not on programs. Acknowledge our functions as planters and waterers. Remember, planters are starters and waterers are sustainers. And build the foundation on Jesus from a position of grace. Amen, everybody? Amen. So before I move to the message, I want to ask a question. Okay? I want to ask a question to all of you. What would be your perfect Sunday? What would be your perfect Sunday? Is the perfect Sunday is to spend time with family? Is that perfect Sunday to sleep in? Is it that perfect Sunday that you take that nice walk in the morning breeze, having brunch, big breakfast? You know, I Googled how to have a perfect Sunday, and there were all kinds of answers to having the perfect Sunday. I mean, all of us look towards Sunday, right? Amen? I mean, of course, besides church, we want to have that, you know, we want to rest, we want to have that lazy time, because we want to take a break, you want to take a break from a long week of work, you know, family and all those kind of things. We want to have that perfect Sunday where we sit on our couch and probably stare at the TV screen. Perfect Sunday. And perfect Sunday usually means these things, you know, brunch and walking in the morning breeze and all this kind of stuff. But what about a perfect Sunday service? What would be a perfect Sunday service looks like? Today I want to bring your attention to what I think is the most perfect Sunday service. It's not on a Sunday to begin with, but I would say a perfect gathering, a perfect Christian gathering. Okay? So we're going to read from this passage taken from Acts 2, verse 42 to 47. Now, before I read it, or before we read it, a little bit of context for this passage is that this passage was written when after Jesus died on the cross, given his life on the cross. And then God raised him from the dead. He defeats death, hell, grave, and sin. And this is the biggest, greatest news in the history of the world, because there's nothing like that. And if you read in, you know, Acts 2, there was a lot that happened. The Holy Spirit came, filled the people, and they spoke in tongues. Then there is Peter, who is a lot like the rest of us. He was kind of a messed up person, but Jesus changed his life, forgave him. And the best crazy thing about Peter is that this is the Peter who denied Jesus, and he preached about repentance, about grace, about the gospel. And what happens following after that, that it was such a power phenomenon, Holy Spirit movement, that 3,000 people were saved. But it didn't stop there, no? Because right after that, we get to see what the New Testament believers did as the church. So we're going to read this together. Acts chapter 2, verse 42 to 47. Let's read it together. 1, 2, 3. All the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. A deep sense of awe came over them all, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. And all the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people. And each day the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved. Amen. Let's bow our heads and pray. Father, we thank you for this word. We pray that, Lord, you will, even right now, speak to us. Holy Spirit, do what you need to do, O God. Make your way into this place. Have us convicted. Have us inspired or challenged, O God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Isn't that, if you read that passage, isn't that the perfect gathering for a church? That's perfect, you know. Because everyone was united in Christ. They ate together. Everything is together. They ate together. They fellowship with one another. They worship God together. You know, C.S. Lewis puts it this way. The perfect church service would be one we were almost unaware of. Our attention would have been on God. But let's be real. Unfortunately, today's church focus has been on things that either that don't matter or for selfish reasons. Things has changed. A lot has changed from that first perfect gathering, you know, that was in the Bible, in ancient times. And I read somewhere that if we were to compare that church to today's church, what would be the comparison be? It goes like this. It goes like this. They were devoted to their comfort, happiness, personal goals, dreams, bucket lists. No one really noticed the Christians because they focus on themselves. Very few of the believers were together. And when they were, they fought about stupid things. If they sold anything, they used the money to buy something better for themselves. They claim to love God, but they don't even love each other. So they felt empty, alone, and depressed. And as a result, most people disliked them and very few lives were changed. And let me be blunt here, is that this is what's happening, okay, in most churches. It's very, very unfortunate. It's very, very sad. Because we come here individualistic mindset. We come here, we consume what we want. God, you do this, you do that. And when we get what we want, we go back. But there is a biblical perfect gathering that God has intended for all of us to have. Not coming as individuals, but individuals collectively. That's why we chose this theme, we are the church. There must be some kind of connection that we all have for one another, whether the young and the old. And it's okay, let me tell you this, it's okay to be with, you know, to find your gang, you know, to find your group. It's okay. But it's dangerous when it becomes a clique. Because when you are in a clique, you don't want to be in another clique, in another group. You don't want, you're too much in your comfort zone, in your own clique, that you won't be able to reach out to another person. Do you get what I'm saying? And church is not supposed to be like that, right? God has something way, way better for this church.
We come here, we want revival, we want restoration, we want things, that God to do in our lives, but we don't do this basic thing. And so if we want a change for this church, for this year, and for the many years to come, I would suggest we need to go back to the basics. We need to have a mindset about what our role is, what we are to do, and who we are to be in this church. So three things I'm going to share with all of us here today from this passage. The first one would be committed. Everybody say committed. Verse 42, it says, all the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to sharing in meals and to prayer. Think about it for a second. How many of us actually devoted ourselves in the Word of God? How many actually, all of us actually devoted ourselves to fellowship? Now, I'm not saying that, diving deep into the Bible, diving deep into fellowship, diving deep in prayer is not an easy thing. It does take some kind of effort. It does. All right? But how many of us even have that kind of heart of devotion to do all of these things? And verse 43 says this, and it's very important. It says, a deep sense of awe came over them all. All the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. You look at that word, a deep sense of awe. Now, the word awe in Greek is called phobos, which means fear, but a positive kind of fear. Not the fear where you are terrified or a morbid terror, or you're scared, but it's a deep respect or reverence. You see, you don't come to church waiting for the worship team to get you into that kind of deep sense of awe. No? You don't come here to church waiting for someone to tell you some good thing that you want to hear so that you can be in a deep sense of awe. No, the believers devoted themselves. They took the initiative. They took that proactiveness to dive deep into the Word, into fellowship, and into prayer. And so what follows a devotion to God is that deep sense of awe. A deep sense of awe, a fear, and a deep respect and reverence to God to a point that we can't do anything. We have to worship God. Think about this. One day, the king comes to you and say, I want to come to your house. You have to do an open house. When you open your house, what's the first thing that you would do? You probably come up with the menu, what should I serve him? And how would I decorate my house? How will I make sure everything is in place? So when the king comes, he won't go like, oh my goodness, this is, are you not ready for me? I'm the king. I'm supposed to come into your house. Aren't you supposed to do something? And we don't want that, as Christians. We want to be ready to receive that deep sense of awe upon us. But how do we do that? It is through worship. It is through worship. It's through a sense of devotion to all the things of God. Question: when does worship happen? Worship does not happen when the music builds up. Just now, Jonas was like a DJ, dun, 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 dun. Builds up to that nice sweet spot, and then slowly all our hands lift up our hands at the nice sweet spot where all the chords, all our voices, all the notes come together, and then there is like a nice big crescendo, a big ending. Worship does not happen then. Do you understand what I'm saying? Worship does not happen like that. Worship does not happen when your favorite song is played. In fact, worship is not music. Worship, like all of us would know, is a lifestyle. It is a lifestyle. Worship is an everyday thing. And having everything in your life revolves around God. When people say, I worship God through music, sure.
I worship God in reading the Bible. Yes. I worship God in giving. Yes. All of these things are things that we should be devoted to. Worship is devoting ourselves to God, as what Romans 12 verse 2 says, as a living sacrifice. That's when worship happens. Not at that right sweet spot where we all lift up our hands. Just now when I was looking at all of you, I was observing, One Voice, just now that song. It's just a killer song, man. And I know all of us also like Living Hope one. Living Hope is like that song. All of us will lift up our hands. But what happens if there's no song? What happens when the music is gone? What happens when one day our church is persecuted? Can we still worship God? The Greek word for devoted here is proskartereo. It means living in a constant state of relentless pursuit. Are we pursuing the things of God? Are we pursuing? Pursuing is relentless, no? Which means is that no matter how you feel or no matter what people say, you still want to pursue the things of God. It is a persistent, ongoing, or if I put it bluntly, obsessed devotion. It's an obsessed devotion that we can't get enough of God. You think about it in Acts. Earlier, they encountered God in such a miraculous and powerful way, but that didn't stop there, no. It's like all of us going to church camps. We all love church camps. We go to church camp from away from the city, 3 days in, 2 nights like this. And we are expecting God to do something, and then we get it. But right after that, it's like the fire is gone already. What happened? That kind of encounter in church camps or in church services like that should help us or should move us to want more for the things of God. It is this constant, relentless pursuit for God. How many of us would actually have that? Let me tell you this, we don't come to church for bite-sized Christianity, you know. We come to church, scroll through Instagram and scroll through Facebook or Twitter, and we have all these nice quotes that hits us. But those are bite-sized. How many of us would take one big bite of the things of God, looking into the Word, praying, and in fellowship? Devotion is a relentless pursuit, a committed pursuit. And our obsessed pursuit. And a lot of us come with a lot of commitment and a lot of obsessions. We are all humans, we come with all of that. Some of us, we are committed to our kids, which is a good thing. But having kids can mean busyness for parents. And in a blink of an eye, parents will find their kids revolving around them. Their lives is revolving around kids. And slowly but surely, who knows, the devotion to God starts to fade. And for those who are working, especially for the young generation, we commit such a big part of our lives to work and career, which is not a bad thing. Somebody told me this, no? This person said she worked from Monday to Friday, 60 hours. 60 hours of work. It's not a bad thing. It is a good thing. In fact, I pray for all of you, the younger generation, to go. You know, go and work. Go and be successful. However, when success and career comes even as equal to God or more than God, that's where your devotion lies. You see, this is a message for all of us, not just the young people. We need to go back to our first love to God. We have to go back. We have to remember our beginnings. When was that last time when you actually kneel down and pray, you know, for yourself, for your family, for God to change you? When was that prayer said? You see, far too many people today will call themselves as followers of Christ, but they have a casual or comfortable approach. You know, I call this as cultural Christians rather than committed Christians. But all these believers in Acts, these first century believers, they were sold out. They were all in. They were fully devoted followers of Christ. And we need to learn whom we set our devotion, because in our impatient culture, we want to experience biblical awe without biblical devotion. If any of us would just come to that relentless pursuit, the mindset of relentless pursuit for God, then God will pour down His Spirit. At the core of our dysfunction is not necessarily style or structure, but lack of devotion. We have been catering our worship to the worshippers and not to Jesus, the object of our worship. And we suddenly become human-centered churches. Another thing about devotion is this, is that when we are devoted to God, when we are devoted to the things of God, we will also be more intimate with Christ. Look at here in Ephesians. Ephesians 5 verse 25 says, "For husbands, this means love your wives just as Christ loved the church. He gave up His life for her." 31, "As the scripture says, a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife, and the two are united into one. This is a great mystery, but it is an illustration of the way Christ and the church are one." One day, if somebody came to me, or any one of you here, somebody come to me and say, "David, I love you. You are doing great things for God and you're such a great person, nice person. I just love being with you." I say, "Okay, thank you very much. But your wife, I cannot tahan your wife, you know. Your wife is this, your wife is that. I cannot." What do you think my response would be? Slap the fella. No, not exactly. Slap in my mind. I would tell the person off. I say, "How can you talk to my wife about my wife like that in front of me? You know, that's very rude. She is my wife and I'm her husband. If you talk bad about her in front of me, then I have to tell you off. If you talk bad about me to her, she will tell you off." You see, the church is the bride of Christ. You talk bad about the church, you talk bad about Jesus. You speak ill of the church, you are speaking ill of Jesus. Of course, the church is not perfect. There's a lot of things that sometimes we will complain and stuff like that. But make sure that your mind, your motive is not to just complain. Because if the more you do it, the more you're actually complaining about Jesus. And that's the kind of intimacy that Jesus wants with the church. The kind of intimacy that Jesus will fight for you, protect the church. And how we would also stand up, rise up, defend our faith, defend Jesus. Christ and the church are one. If when we are devoted, that's the kind of intimacy that we will have with Jesus. You know, like sometimes when we go out, non-Christians will say, "Wow, Christians are hypocrites." Well, what will be the? Yeah, Lord, I also think the same way. Not necessarily we have to say like that, but we can always say that, "No, that's not what church is all about. That's not what Christianity is about. We are not perfect, but Jesus is. Jesus gave up His life for the church. The church is not started on the spot spontaneously. God wants His church to come back and to be devoted to Him. We need to be a church that is committed in intimacy, pursuing the things of God. We need to be a church that is intensely devoted to the things that matters most, not a casual, comfortable Christianity, but a full devotion to God. This is something for you guys to reflect. When you go home after this, where do you put your devotion to? If you put your devotion to career, to work, to family, to spouse, then you've got to really set your priorities aside. Because if we really want that deep sense of awe to come upon this church, then we need to start devoting to committing ourselves to the things of God. Next one is this, commune, right? Verse 44, it says, all the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshipped together at the temple each day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy and generosity. You see, the thing that God wants for His church is to commune with one another. We are a congregation, all right? We are a congregation that communes one another. That is the thing that God wants for all of us in this church. You see, the gathering does not limit to this building, but also in homes. Like all of us, we all gathered here, but it's also that intimate place, you know, homes, where you invite people to come to your place to show, you know, that I want to have that kind of communion with you. That is what God wants us to have. And because life group ministry is under me, and I want to really talk about life groups, okay? Because like I said, this is not here and, you know, we don't start here and end here, but we as the day goes, we also meet each other, you know, in our private homes and stuff like that. So life groups are a place, a platform where we can live life together. We help each other to provide the things that we need. And the first goal of life group is to comfort the afflicted and to afflict the comfortable. If any one of us here today and you come with a broken heart, life groups are a place to share your worries, to share your concerns, to confess your sins, to be prayed for, to be comforted. But on the other hand, if you come too comfortable, not wanting to move away from your comfort zone, even as God moves you, then you will be afflicted. Afflicted here, in this context, I don't mean to cause pain over you, but I'll definitely give you a hard time. I'll definitely ask you. I'll definitely pursue you and say, if your life is not in accordance to the Word of God, if your life has some sort of habit or some sort of addiction in your life, I will have to come to you if I've ever see it, and I have to give you a hard time. I have to give you a hard time. But of course, giving you a hard time is to push you and to convince you so that you will be restored. That is what life group is. Life group is to comfort the afflicted and to afflict the comfortable. Secondly, is life group is a place not just to hear, but listen. You know, we live in a culture that is really easy to hear and not listen. How many of you husbands and wives, you tell each other, hey, are you hearing me or not? Yes, you hear me, but are you listening to me? Life groups is a place where we can listen to one another. Because hearing one another or hearing the Word of God is not enough. Listening leads us to action. Life groups are more of listening than instructing. It's easy to come right here in the front row and then get up, not talk to anybody, walk out of the hall, go in your car, and then before you know it, whatever you've learned today is gone in. One ear and out the other. Life groups, a communion like this, takes us from a big room like this and puts us in a small room where, honestly speaking, we won't be able to hide it and we have to talk about it. We are forced to be challenged, we're forced to change and grow from this place to this place. Because right now, all of us, we can hide in a big place like this, but you can never hide in a room of 10. But this is a good thing. Alright, don't take it as like, oh, you're scared already, I don't want to come for life group. This is a good thing, you know why? Because then we will be able to be accountable to one another. You see, I've got nothing to hide. I've told you already, I was a porn addicted person. I watched pornography. I can be true with you. Not watching now, but I've watched it before. I was addicted to it. Too addicted to it too much that because of that, the way how it affected my perspective of people is terrible. It was bad. And I had to tell somebody, because if you don't, something will be built up in you, so much so that you'll be numb to it. So numb that you will live with it. And if you live with it, you can never live to the fullest potential that God wants you to live. And life groups, it's not supposed to be intimidating. It's supposed to be inviting for all of us to share whatever that is deep down in us that we can't seem to get it off. Life groups are, you see, there's no point in having big gatherings like this. No point. When we don't even dare to go into small groups. This kind of gatherings don't end here. It's an ongoing thing. And life groups is important. Life groups is a chance and a platform for all of us to, you know, from spectators into participators. When you're in life group, you're able to speak life into the other person. You can. That's life group. Life group is no longer where we just consume, but we are communing with one another. You know, I'd like to share this for all of us. This vision that I had for our life group ministry this year is that I call this a circle of life. I want this church, by the way, this church is not a big church. It's a very small church. It's a family church. And I love it. You know, and if it's such a family church, it's such a small church, then I don't think it's any difficult for us to really connect and commune with one another. Look at this. Let's take for me an example. This is a circle of life that I'm in, where in life groups, I want to look up to people who is older than me, ahead of me. You know, I look up to my parents, I look up to like people like Auntie Kimoy, I look up to my parents-in-law. These are the people that I know that will speak life into me and that I can always depend on. People who are older, people who are more experienced, people who have gone through struggles, like really big struggles, and they can speak life into me. Also, I can also learn from people who are of my same peer, you know, people who are alongside of me, you know, people who also go through the same thing as me. And I also can learn from people, and listen very carefully, I can learn from people who are behind me, who are younger than me. Sometimes all of us, we get the older ones, like we get very intimidated by younger people. If when younger people are doing, you know, better than you and doing more stuff than you. But there's something that the younger generation, especially the next generation, can actually speak life into all of us. So let's not stop at just gathering like this. Have we been doing this now? The older ones, mentor the younger ones. The younger ones, don't dismiss the older ones. There's something that you can learn from the older ones. And the older ones, something that you can learn from the younger ones. This is a circle of life. That when we need to be a church that communes, involve, and participate in each other's life. Lastly is this. Contagious. Verse 47 says, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people, each day the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved. You know, other than actually going out of these four walls and actually evangelizing and spreading the gospel, we need to reach in first before we reach out. If our church in here is not doing so well, if we don't even commune in one another and fellowship and pray for one another with what, I mean, whatever that I just mentioned just now, then how are we going to reach out? We have to reach in before we reach out. And when I think about church and I think about life groups, I think about fellowship like this, this is the sentence that should be the one that inspires all of us. Because all the devotion, all the commitment, all the communion becomes contagious. It will become contagious. You see, we don't measure our community strictly in numbers. No. Because only God gives the growth. That's what I preached last week. But we do have to measure ourselves, our church, in some ways, whether that God is giving the growth or not. And the growth here I'm talking about is that if we are so committed but not compelling, then we need to ask really serious questions, what we are actually committed to. Let me say it again. If we are committed but not compelling to anyone, we need to ask serious questions about what we are really actually committed to. every single church in the world has a mission statement, like make disciples, baptizing them, you know, teaching them. Everyone has this. But do we actually do it or not? God didn't mean for all of us to make this, God didn't mean for some of us to make disciples. God mean for all of us, every Christian, to win the lost, to build them into discipleship. God intends for this church to be a contagious church. You know, the mission of our church is making disciples who make disciples. Are we a contagious church now? Are we the kind of people that we only commit to things that we Christians know how to do? But one day when a non-Christian comes or a visitor comes, can they feel this contagious thing that we are having or not? Because everyone is fellowshipping with one another, no gossip, no slandering, just really, you know, happy, just being with together, praying for one another. We are so comfortable to each other that we trust each other. We pray for one another. We confess our sins to one another. Are we a contagious church? Because if we are, then people will see. People will come. People will know that this is a community that I want to be in. You know, this quote, it says, spiritual interest is at a high level in our culture, but so is bewilderment about what to believe. You know, we are all spiritual beings. And there is a need in us, not just in us, in those people who are, you know, non-believers, that craves for something supernatural. Outside of this church, you think that we are here very supernatural and religious, but outside they also can do the same thing. Of course, the thing is that theirs is not from God. Ours is from God. And even if a person is not like religious, but they are always searching and craving for something supernatural, they go to yoga, meditation, anything to connect themselves to a higher power. And there's all kinds of spirituality out there. But the problem is, we know the truth. We know what's right. But they don't know. They don't know. We have to understand that we are spiritual beings made in the image of God, but they are also spiritual beings made in the image of God. We need to really step out from our comfort zone and be a contagious church through devoting ourselves, committing ourselves to the things of God, communing with one another. When was the last time you actually talked to someone? Or have you always been coming to church individual, doing the things that you want to do and then go back? That's why life groups are very important. And we'll talk about that in the coming weeks. So being a contagious church is that, one of the things about being a contagious church is that evangelism is very important. Evangelism is one of the highest values in church, but one of the least practiced. Jesus commissioned us to be a persuasive communicator. The gospel is not only to inform, but it's also to impact. He asks us to be a contagious church, a contagious Christian, to build a contagious church. Somewhere I read in, I think I read somewhere on the internet, I can't remember what exactly, but there's an article of this, I think it's a politician or something like that, in the States. You know, he claims himself to be a Christian, but he said this, my faith is my own. It's not supposed to be public. It is a private matter to me. And I really disagree with that, because your faith in God shouldn't be private. It should be public. You know, it shouldn't. That's why we do water baptisms and stuff like that and call everybody to come. Why? Because we want our faith to be public. It's not a private matter. It's for us to shine. We are the light of the world. You know, Matthew 5 says that don't put a lamp, your light, under a bowl, because it doesn't make any sense. It's supposed to be out of the bowl, and so that it can lead to shine for everyone to see. Imagine this, if I off all the lights, every light here, no lights coming out from outside or whatever, it'd be pitch dark. If I only light a candle, all of us will see the candle. You won't see darkness, but you'll see the light. It's not supposed to be private. It's supposed to be public. How many of us are actually Christians who live a public faith, not a private faith? Because if you were to be a public faith, then we are able to be contagious. Can I have the musicians to come here? I say this with all seriousness, is that we can talk about all these three things are on its own, like to be committed, you know, we need to be committed. But all these three comes together. If you are very committed but you are not communing with one another, it doesn't make sense. If you're all about being contagious and evangelizing and spreading the gospel, but you don't even have communion with one another, it doesn't make sense. It has to come three, all together as one. And that's who we are. We are the church, meaning we are the kind of church that we do these things. That not only we are committed, we also fellowship with one another. Now, fellowship with one another does not only limit to, you know, we don't go to cliques, but we know we have that, you know, discernment and that wisdom from God to tell, to know how to go to the other person and reach out to that person. We need to talk about this more. We need to really focus on these three things. Because when we don't do this, then there's no point of having church. This is what church is all about. Can we all stand? Shall we all stand? So last week, right, when we talk about planters and waterers, I know it's a very gung-ho kind of message. But these are also the things that we mustn't forget. We are a church, must come with these three C's. Not just finding your place of whether am I a planter or am I a waterer. That's also one part, but the other part is also being these three things. So I hope that this message really sink into all of us. This is the time, this is the era for us to really step up, rise up to do these three things. Because if not, the church will be just, I know, just doesn't, it, things won't happen in church. All right, so let's sing this song. And then let's sing this song and allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us today. Amen.
Of you this day, coming here alive, in a house
maybe seen in us, then the world will know that Jesus Christ is Lord. Let us be one voice that glorifies your name. Let us be one voice declaring that you reign. Let us be one voice in love and harmony. And we pray, O God, grant us unity. Now is the time
for you and I. Join the heart. Let the name of Jesus.
Lift up your hands and sing.
There will be one voice that glorifies your name. Let us be one voice declaring that you reign. Let us be one voice in love and harmony. And we pray, O God, grant
grandest unity.
Let us be one voice. Everybody, just close your eyes. Maybe right now the Holy Spirit is speaking to some of you individually. Maybe God is putting a person in your life that you feel a burden for. A person in your life that you want to reach out to. You see, all of us, whether or not we say it or not, is that we all come with some kind of brokenheartedness. In our facade, we look like we are okay. But many of us here today, sometimes in us, we don't feel okay. We got some kind of a habit or an addiction or some kind that is pulling us away from God. And you have that potential to reach out to that person. Ask God to give you the discernment. Ask God to give you that wisdom to reach out to that person. Don't be afraid. Because we are a family, and I want to be with someone who will speak life to me. I want to look up to the person and speak life to me. If you have a word for that person, speak life into that person. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Because at the end of the day, we are all one unit in Christ. We are doing this so that we can be of Christ and not of anyone else. We are doing this because we love each other. We want the best for each other. Father, we commit, oh God, this message into your hands. The Lord, this message, this word will pierce through every heart today. God, I pray that, Lord, you will challenge each of us, oh God. A person, oh God, give us a person, oh Lord, that we can have a burden for, to pray, to reach out, oh God. Because this is what we want to do. This is a church that looks out for each other. This is a church of God that shares each other's burdens. This is a church of God that will pray for each other. Lord, sometimes in the facade, we are okay. But God, there's just something in us that needs to be let out. And we need you, Lord. Give us that person, oh God. Give us that person that can speak life into us. Let us be a church of God. Right now, let us come to you and be a church that is committed to you. That, Lord, we will pursue the things of God. We won't pursue on anything else. We won't put anything else as first and priority in our lives, but only you and the things of God to be first. And help us, O God, to also commune with one another. And help us, O God, to reach in before we reach out. Help us to be a contagious church, that we do the things of God so well that, Lord, this place will be so contagious that outside people will see that we are of a church who lives and glorifies you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. I feel very deep in my spirit right now. I want to open up the altar to pray for anyone here today. It's nothing really have to do with the message today, but I just want to speak life into someone today. I just want to pray for someone that you feel that there's something in you that's holding you back. There's something in you that just, you know, you feel dry. You know, you feel dry spiritually. You feel dry just generally. And you just feel like, you know, you feel like this life that we are living is like so meaningless. But God has a purpose and a plan for all of us. And I want to open up the altar for anyone here today that can come and just be prayed for. And if any one of us also, that any one of here today that wants to be prayed for healing and for diseases to be to be cast out, I want to pray for you as well. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
What key is this? Do you know how to change my heart?
Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you. You are the potter. I am the clay. Mold me and make me. This is what I pray. Sings, change my heart. Really telling all of us here today, if you really have something that God, there's something that's holding you back from God, I really would like to ask all of any one of you who needs to be prayed for. It can be anything. It could be career, it could be family, it could be anything that's holding you back, and you want to be free of that because you want to be where God wants you to be. If you need that prayer, please come to the front and then I will pray for you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You are the potter. Thank you.
Father, this is your church, and we are your church, O God. Lord, help us, O Lord, to do church, O God, your way. Help us, O God, to set aside programs or strategies or styles. All of that is important, but God, that does not equal to you. Help us, O God, to be a church that is committed to the things of God, communing with one another in fellowship, in prayer. Also, O God, help us to be a church, O Lord, that is contagious, reaching in before we reach out, O God. Let this be a church, Lord, like a city on a hill that cannot be hidden, that for far away, O God, people will see that this church, O God, a church that belongs to the one true living God, that only wants to spread the gospel and see lost people, O God, come to you in salvation, O Lord. This is what we want to see, O God. Not the numbers added to this church, not the numerical growth, but the kind of growth, O Lord, that grows in grace and knowledge of you, O Lord. Oh God, I commit this church, O Lord. I commit everyone that was being prayed for, that God, this will not end here and this will not end this place, but Holy Spirit, you will continue to speak into their lives, O God. Continue, O Lord, to challenge them and convict them, O God, that in whatever they do, they know they're doing it for your glory, and they know that, Lord, that Lord, your Holy Spirit is leading me in this path of righteousness, O God. We are not perfect, but Lord, in our weakness, you are perfect. When we are weak, you are strong. And so we depend and lean on that promise. We thank you, O God. We pray that as we leave this place, God, your presence to be with us. Give us new perspectives. Give us new strengths. And give us new mindsets, O God, for us to live for you. In Jesus' name I pray. And all God's people say, Amen. Thank you, everyone. You may be dismissed.
remember, go and register your names behind there for Uncle Jason's Bible study session.